Okay, so what I'm going to do for you in the next few minutes is describe a summary of the research that my group has carried out during the last 6 years or so. And what I'm going to be emphasizing is research carried out on a place called Effingham Inlet, on the west coast of Vancouver Island, and several fjords that are further up the coast of British Columbia. Now, this looks like a small area, but this is probably about the size of Western Europe right here. So this covers a very wide geographic region. And we'll be looking at places that are in two very different oceanographic regimes. Effingham Inlet is in an upwelling zone around here where waters are being influencing this area from the open ocean, whereas these areas up here are more restricted and it's more influenced by continental-type processes. So here is the fjord opening. There are a couple of basins that are found here, and these are what are of interest to us. And the reason for that is that, this is the open ocean, is that there are sills. And these sills block the flow of water coming from the open ocean and resulting in these inner basins having little oxygen circulation down to the bottom of them. So the water flow comes in like this, and then it becomes stagnant at the bottom. In this outer basin, conditions are dysoxic. That means that there's very little oxygen. But in the inner basin, there's no oxygen whatsoever. And that is really nice for us, because what that means is it records sediment undisturbed by any animals crawling around on the bottom. So basically, year by year, we have a very, very continuous record for several thousand years. This is the another shot, but this is further north now. This is the Seymour Belize Inlet Complex on the mainland coast of British Columbia. And we're looking at several fjords that stretch, you know, several, maybe 30 kilometers inland, and they are very restricted. There is something here called the Nakwatko Rapids, which basically block the main circulation of water coming in from the ocean. So it's very difficult for all the water to exchange on the turn of a tide. And as a result, it becomes anoxic in here as well, but for very, very different reasons than we see before. And this is just a shot, again, superficially, looks very similar to what we saw in Effingham Inlet, but oceanographically very different. And these are shots of some of the equipment that we use as we take our cores. Now, everything in the Northeast Pacific, all the way from California on up into Alaska, is controlled by two weather systems. Okay, the Aleutian Low dominates this region in the wintertime, and it results in very rainy conditions. And when it's raining in those narrow fjords, that results in a lot of sediment being sloughed off into the basin and forms layers. So this is what happens in the winter. In the summertime, we end up with sunnier, drier conditions. But what happens then is, because the way that this weather system has a gyre which goes in a clockwise fashion, it results in upwelling. And so it's warm and dry, so there's no sediment washing into the fjords, but we end up with all this nice minerals are being brought up from the deep ocean, and that allows the phytoplankton to grow, and we end up with very thick layers of things like diatoms and various other microfossils that we can look at in our record. So those are the two dominant controls over climate. So here's another shot showing some of the large cores. This is very expensive research. These ships cost $25,000 a day with a large crew. These cores here are very heavy, weigh several tons. If you do not handle it correctly, somebody could become hurt or lose a finger or something like that, which happens periodically. So here's a core about to be dropped into the ocean. The sediment is very mucky, this stuff. So at the very surface of it, these cores are so heavy, they sometimes overshoot and go deeper into the sediment. So to get the very top of the sediment, we use something called a freeze core. And what this does is drops down to the sediment, and it's filled with dry ice. The dry ice results, after about 20 minutes, all the sediment around it being frozen to it, and then you extract it, and we end up with a perfect record. And here's a little bit of mud frozen at the side of that. So we get this record right up to last week, basically, when we're collecting these sediments. And here's what you end up with. Here's what this mud looks like, and it's basically about 5,000 years of mud. There's not enough time here for this stuff to turn to rock or anything, so we're just looking at soft mud that has layers in it, and here's what we see. And I mentioned that what we see is everything here is controlled by the North Pacific High and the Aleutian Low. And so in the wintertime, when this region is much rainier, we have the Aleutian Low dominating, and we have a lot more grains being washed into the inlet, and this we end up with these darker layers. And you can see, looking up through this, that no 2 years alike. Look at this. This tells us that this was a rainier time. And I mentioned the North Pacific highs when we hit upwelling, and the phytoplankton loved that. Look at these thick layers right here. These are years where the diatoms loved it. And so they had thick layers being laid down. Over time, things change. The North Pacific high may dominate for a few years in a particular orientation. The Aleutian low may do it for a few more years. And it forms these cycles and trends. And we scan this with a computer, and the computer can look at the thickness of the layers and can look at the changes in the darkness of the layers. And that can, the cycles and trends that the computer can recognize, we call it a time series analysis, allows us to see, is climate cyclic? Does it have any particular trends? And that's really important because, for example, this Northeast Pacific region has only been inhabited by Europeans with thermometers since really well into the 19th century. We have no record much. And so it's very important if we want to understand climate, which often is varying on cycles longer than our lifespan, we need to look at these very complete records. And the record that we have in this region extends back at least 5,000 years. And it's at this sort of resolution, so it's unprecedented. This is one of the highest quality climate records that are available anywhere. Now, the first little core I'll show you is a freeze core. I showed you one of these ones. This was taken from Effingham Inlet. And this is where the core was taken, run from this anoxic basin in here, anoxic with no oxygen in it. So there was no oxygen down at the bottom waters right here. The bottom of the core bottomed out in an earthquake record. There was a slump in 1946. There was a major earthquake in this area. And it ended in 1993. We didn't get right up to the top because as we pulled the freeze core up, it had to come up through 200 meters of water and it washed some material away. But we went year by year by year by year by year, counting all the diatoms. We dated it so we know all the different things that were going on around here. So we did something called time series analysis. As I mentioned, that the computers that we have scan the x-rays right here and recognize changes in the thickness of the layers and their grayscale. So the variations are found. And when we did this, we did something, I love this, wavelet analysis right here. This is a type of time series analysis which allows you to recognize trends visually in something. And so what we see here, this all these little blobby bits up here is the annual layers. Every year a layer, so it can recognize that. It also recognized in here, at this level right here, that occasionally an El Nino impacts the area. The Northeast Pacific, if there's a big El Nino, has a major influence upon climate. We're a little further north. It doesn't always happen. So once in a while, we have some El Ninos. But the big thing that was happening throughout this entire record was a 10 to 12 year cycle that was dominant throughout. And we picked up the same thing when we did a different type of time series analysis called spectral analysis. We recognized an 11-year cycle in the grain size that are washed in the wintertime and also with the diatoms. And so they had the same 11-year cycle. So this was cool. We said, what's causing this 11-year cycle? Then we went and looked at those long piston cores, the ones that were taken with these great big cores that weighed several tons that are lower down to the ocean bottom. And this record here extends from about 2,000 years ago or 1,800 years ago back to nearly 5,000 years ago. And what we saw when we did the same sort of wavelet analysis in here was that we had all these solar cycles. The 11-year cycle is called a Schwabe cycle, but piggybacking on top of that are longer solar cycle. Here's one's called the Gleisberg cycle, which is 75 to 90 years, something called a Suess cycle, and then a very long cycle called a Bond cycle. And these showed up here quite clearly through here. And we also, so here's the Gleisberg cycles right here, and here is the Suess cycle, and there was a major oceanographic cut here. So I'll describe that. And here shows it more clearly. And what I'm emphasizing here are the Gleisberg cycles because to discuss everything would take a long time. So here's a Gleisberg cycle blipping in. This is a solar cycle which is 75 to 90 years. Here's another one, and another one. So they gain strength, they fade out, gain strength, they fade out. Here is the Suess cycles. This major cut right here, 3,500 years ago, this marked a neo-glaciation. There was renewed glaciation in this entire region about 3,500 years ago, which we pick up in the oceanographic record as well. So something major was going on oceanographically as well as in the ocean. Major funding for this research on the West Coast was initially from the Natural Sciences and Engineering Research Council of Canada. And the main reason I got this money was that there was problems on the West Coast. They had these major fisheries going on with various species that they go on quite nicely, then all of a sudden they crash. There'll be a major fishery one year, and there'll be none the next. Problem is, their fishery records are very short. They only reach back into the early 20th century in many cases. And so the fisheries managers were very, very interested in understanding, are there cycles and trends in fishing? And so we were mandated to look at these cores to see if we could find any records of fish remains to see if they would tell something about, are there actually cycles in here? The two important commercial species we looked at were northern anchovy and also Pacific herring. Okay, and they have been found to undergo significant population changes through time in this region, and as a result, they were a good target for us. Now, again, because of the brief fishing records which existed for these important species, it's really important for us to go back and try and see whether they change over time, because there are huge fleets. There's thousands of people employed in these fisheries, and their success of them, they want to know, are they going to crash? What drives it? We had the same problem on the West Coast with salmon fisheries, and that they don't understand those very well as well. One year, they'll have a huge population comes out of nowhere, and the next year, it'll be nearly gone. They blame it on overfishing, they blame it on oceanographic changes, but no one really knows for sure. So in order to understand these things, you need to look at the longer record. Well, here's Pacific herring, and this is what we look at. This is a nice drawing of a Pacific herring. This is what a modern scale looks like, and when we look in these little sediment layers, we pick them apart, you can find fossil scales. And I have students that count these things, and they look at changes over time. Sometimes in the core there'll be almost none, other times will be very abundant, and we can employ statistical methods to try and figure out how they exist. Now, it's a cool water species, and in Effingham Inlet, it was at very near its southern limit. So that's a great place to be, so if you're on the margin. And it likes to conditions when annual water temperatures are above average. And so if you find warmer waters around there, you'll tend to find more of these things. So that's what controls Pacific herring. Northern anchovy, and this is a picture of its scale, and even to a lay person, I think you can see there are very distinct differences in these scales, and so it's a very easy tool to try and count the relative abundance of these things. Now, it's at the northern end of its range in Effingham Inlet, and it likes it during enhanced upwelling. So lots of upwelling around, you find lots of these things. And as you saw just on that little graph, or on the x-ray of the core, that the conditions vary considerably in Effingham Inlet. And they'll vary considerably at longer scales as well. And this is what we wanted to look at. And this is what we saw, is that just as I showed you with the diatom and the sediment records a few minutes ago, the anchovy and the herring are fading in and fading out over time. And so that they have these long records. So here's the Gleisberg cycle. You can see them fading in and fading out. Here's the Seuss cycle right here. And they both underwent this major cut 3,500 years ago. And they continue to go on to the present time. Now, right now, we've finished off an anchovy regime right now. We're ready to have some herring seemingly start to come back again. But you can see enormous abundances of these things at time fading in and fading out in response to what seems to be solar cycles. So here we are at higher trophic organisms that are feeding basically well up the food chain, also responding to the same drivers which seem to be controlling the diatoms and the sediments that we saw. As we were began to develop some hypotheses as what might be controlling the patterns we were seeing, we saw all these solar cycles. What was a eureka moment for us was when we began to read literature which pointed out how climate amplifiers are influencing the solar cycle. And it's interesting, there are literally hundreds and hundreds of papers that have been carried out which have found apparent links between solar cycles and climate, which was quite heartening to us. The problem was, and here's an example right here, here's sunspots number right here, and this looks at global mean sea surface temperature, so they match up quite nicely. Here's another record right here, for example. This shows the surface temperature over time. This is looking at changes in solar radiation, and this little dotty line right here is the actual thermometer record. They match up very closely as well. We also found solar cycles as well in other records from our region. This is one right here looking at tree ring widths in the Kola Peninsula, which is up in northern Russia, and they found the same Gleisberg cycle we see, this hail cycle, which is a 22-year solar cycle and our 11-year cycle. So they were very clear, and this is all across the high Arctic, and there are many, many other records as well right around where we were doing our research. So let's stop then and pause and talk about just what a solar cycle is and how it might correlate with the records that we see. This is a graphical image showing a transition between solar cycle 23 and solar cycle 24. Here we are right now just at the end of solar cycle 23, ready to start 24. And what happens is the sun across an 11-year sunspot cycle changes the intensity of the energy it produces very slightly. Here's at a solar minimum in 1996. There's hardly any sunspots. And then here's a solar maximum right here. Here's one from 1999. You can see these little sunspots here. Now, when there's an increase in sunspots, there's a slight increase in the amount of energy which the sun produces. And it throws that energy out into the solar system and strikes the Earth. And here it is right here. This is the energy change across. This is from 1978, 88, up to 1998. Here's the peak. Here's a trough right here. The sun's output varies by about 0.1% or 1.4 watts per square meter across an 11-year sunspot cycle. Problem is, and this is the problem that has been with all these research papers, the hundreds of them literally, through the years that saw this correlation between the sunspot cycle and apparent, you know, sea surface temperatures and between global temperature anomaly and so on, is that that's really not much energy. 1.4 watts per square meter across a sunspot cycle will not drive the climate change that we see. If you're going to have climate change, you have to have some kind of amplifier. And this is where everybody has been stymied for years until very, very recently. Now, this is a nice graph right here which basically shows the solar wind. And that solar wind is coming from our sun. And the solar wind is slightly varies a little bit across a sunspot cycle. As you move to the peak of a sunspot cycle, there's more energy being released, and that enhances the solar wind. Now, counteracting that, our solar system is continually being bombarded by cosmic rays. Cosmic rays are stripped-down neutrons, which basically come from supernova within the galaxy. So these are basically continually bombarding our solar system. And when and again, they're trying to get to the inner part, but they're being deflected by the solar wind. During a peak of a sunspot cycle, more cosmic rays are deflected, but some still get through. So when you have a trough in a sunspot cycle, more of these cosmic rays get through to the solar system. And when you have a peak of a sunspot cycle, the solar wind is stronger and more are deflected. And the question then arises, so what? What does that have to do with phytoplankton production in the Northeast Pacific? What does it have to do with Pacific herring or anchovy or the amount of rainfall which creates the dark layers that we see and so on? So let's look at another part of the equation. Clouds are important controls over climate in our planet. Okay? So cloud basically has two effects. Clouds can either result in greenhouse gas, or basically they can act as a blanket which makes the planet warmer, or they can reflect solar energy back out, away from our planet and result in a cooling. Now, the result is that our overall planet, when you have more clouds, there's a cooling going on. So the more clouds, despite there be some result in a warming, some result in cooling, the overall effect is when you have more clouds, you end up with a cooling of the planet. And so the question then is, so what? Again, what do clouds have to do with my anchovies and my phytoplankton? What does it have to do with cosmic ray flux and so on? Well, here is the so what. Here's an interesting correlation that has been measured between low cloud production, between solar radiance and cosmic rays. They match up perfectly. And this has been a measured phenomena. This is not hypothetical. This is actual data taken from a paper by Carleton et al. In 2002. It ends up, the correlation has been that they recognize that more clouds, more cosmic rays, seem to result in more clouds and lower temperatures. And in fact, it's been measured that there's something like a 1.7% variation in low cloud formation between a solar maximum and minimum. So all these three things match up. And so the idea was there must be some kind of, the cosmic rays must have some kind of impact that result in the formation of more clouds. But there was all kinds of hypotheses put out as to why this might happen. And Interestingly, a landmark paper was just published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society in October of 2006 by Svensmark, and they have finally experimentally demonstrated how that happens, how cosmic rays excite electrons and result in forming more cloud nuclei. So we now, and this has been a problem with this hypothesis as a climate driver, is that they really didn't have a mechanism for it, or they had the mechanism, but they didn't have proof. Now they have proof. So let's look then at how this all fits together. The so what between my fish production, my phytoplankton, the clouds, the upwelling, and cosmic rays. See how it all impacts climate. So here's the idea. We have our solar system continually being bombarded by cosmic rays. Cosmic rays enhance cloud production on the Earth. Cloud, the more clouds that you have, results in less solar energy getting through to the Earth's surface and an overall cooling. Counteracting all that is the solar sunspot cycle. During the peak of a sunspot cycle, we end up with more solar energy, more solar wind, which deflects more cosmic rays. More cosmic rays deflected, we end up with fewer clouds. During a trough of a sunspot cycle, we end up with a lesser amount of solar wind, more cosmic rays get through, resulting in more cloud formation and overall cooler conditions, resulting in this graph that we see right here. So this is a smoking gun to explain what's happening. And in fact, the cosmic ray intensity varies by something like 15% across the sunspot cycle, which causes that 1.7% variation in cloud formation. Now, the interesting thing is, that's an 11-year sunspot cycle. As we ramp up to larger sunspot cycles, here's the Gleisberg cycle, the Suess cycle, and so on, that it varies by a factor of 3 to 4. So we end up with a massive change in the percentage, the amount of cloud formation when you move up to these longer solar cycles. So they can have a profound impact upon climate at that point, not just relatively minor impacts. So here is the model which I think controls what we see. But before I do that, I want to explain, show another interesting correlation. There's a paper by Hamid and Lee in 2003 at the American Geophysical Union. They looked at the sunspot cycle, and they correlate it with the center of formation of, or center of action, the place anyway where the Aleutian Low and the North Pacific High form every year. These are annual things that they disappear. The North Pacific High largely disappears in the wintertime. The Aleutian Low largely disappears in the summers. They form every year. But where they start to form varies every year. What they found was there was an interesting correlation between the center of formation of the North Pacific High and the Aleutian Low and the sunspot cycle. And this can start to have an impact, because you think about, well, the North Pacific High controls upwelling, which my phytoplankton love. So if you have the North Pacific High just sitting in the very right spot, in the sweet spot, so to speak, you'll end up with enhanced upwelling and more of my diatoms. And as it moves around, it may move at a different part of the sunspot cycle to a center of formation, which is not so nice, and we have less upwelling. And so this is what I think we're seeing. First of all, what we have is the sunspot cycle celestial modulation, which I described to you, looking at this cosmic ray flux and the sun changing over time. That has a big impact upon cloud formation on the planet as a whole. This, in turn, has an impact on something called planetary waves. Now, this is a fancy term. These are large-scale movements of atmosphere all around the planet, and the best example I can think of is the jet stream. Is a major thing which migrates, and at least on our weather channel here, I look at it every night, and they're always showing, here's a jet stream, and this is why it's crappy here today, or this is why it's going to be nice today. And so this has a big impact upon this, what's happening with the Aleutian Low and the North Pacific High. So this has the correlation right here. Impacts the center of formation of the North Pacific High and the Aleutian Low, which are moving by up to 700 kilometers across the sunspot cycle. So think about what's happening here as we move up to Gleisberg cycles, when you start to enhance the impact by 3 to 4. So this is an enormous impact upon upwelling in this region. And this enhanced upwelling then is what we're seeing with our nutrients and our diatom production. So that's the climatic link between the proxy records that we see in Effingham Inlet and what's happening in the bigger global picture. The other next thing I wanted to show you is that I mentioned with these Gleisberg cycles, they record intervals in here between high sun intervals when you have a peak solar production and intervals when it's lesser. And so here's, again, I showed you this diagram. Here's a high sun activity 4,400 years ago. Here's a low sun. Here's a higher sun interval again. I want to show you exactly what happened right at this point. And we'll look at it actually visually. And this is the nice thing about this sort of a time series analysis. You can actually lay the core down beside it and say, oh, what was going on here? Why does this cycle show up? And here's what happens. This is a 62-year climate record right here from 4,400 years ago, year by year by year. And the question would be, so what? What's the big deal about this? The big deal about this is everybody always talks about, when they talk about climate change and so on, well, you know, climate's going to change suddenly, more suddenly than it ever changed before and so on. Well, you know what? Climate can change very suddenly and it can change very profoundly. And here's an example of that right here. Here are these thick layers right here, year by year by year, and everybody in the room could recognize then these are thicker, lighter layers. These are enhanced upwelling. Okay, this is the high sun interval right up here, when that sort of a light area right here. But look at this record. Right at this point right here, suddenly we moved from a high sun part of a Gleisberg cycle to a low sun one. And almost over the point of one season, we changed to a different climate regime here. We see these darker, thinner layers. The diatom production is greatly reduced now, and now it's a lot of these darker, muddy layers from enhanced rain. The Aleutian Low is starting to dominate at this point, as opposed to the upwelling that was going on with the North Pacific High. And this occurred like that. Okay, so this is massive climate regime shift going on almost instantaneously. So it's ludicrous, the idea that climate can change in all scales. It can change slowly. It can change dramatically, such as we change around here. It can be colder or wetter. The records that we see here show how dramatically fast that change can be. Now, just move to the north for just a couple of slides here to show what's happening up in the more continental regime. Okay, this is Belize Inlet, which is a line right here. All these colors right here basically are showing changes in temperature, oxygen, and salinity that we measure with probes that we stick in to give us water property data. And so this is this long red line. Then this over here is another little inlet, which is blue, which basically you can see changes in temperature, oxygen, and so on. The main point I want to show here is that on top of this inlet up here, the water doesn't have a very high salinity. This is a low salinity wedge around here. It's very fresh. The same thing up here, very fresh water, and it's more saline down below. And what's happening here is that it's difficult for water to become exchanged through this place called the Natwatko Rapids. And the waters here is probably one of the highest tidal flows in the world at 8 meters per second. You'd be swept away if you were put in this water right here. This just shows the standing wave as the tide is turning in this particular place right here. So exchange is very, very difficult. And as a result, this place is not greatly influenced by the ocean, open ocean, like we saw down in the south at Effingham Inlet. It's controlled largely by estuarine flow, the amount of rainfall that's coming into this area from streams or from other sources. So this is what we're seeing, although you do get a little whiff of some temperature change coming into the place. But we see the same pattern up here. The high sun activity, the low sun, high sun, low sun, all responding not so much to upwelling this time, but it's responding to changes in rainfall. As the Aleutian Low, which dumps lots of water around here, moves in, dumps water in this place, and then the North Pacific High so this is when you have North Pacific High, this is Aleutian Low. So this is low rainfall, high rainfall, low rainfall, high rainfall. So it's not upwelling, but it's the same sort of phenomena. So it's a completely different oceanographic regime, but exactly the same sort of pattern going on. And what I think this is analogous to is like the Little Ice Age in Northern Europe. So here's something called the Maunder Minimum. This is a time when sunspot cycles largely disappeared from that part of Europe, or basically from the world. Then they start to reappear again. So here's a sunspot cycle getting longer and longer and longer, a Gleisberg cycle that's piggybacked on top of that, and another one, and here we are up to present time. So we've gone from this sort of a cold condition, low sun conditions, up to much warmer conditions as we have at the present time. So it's the same sort of cycles and trends that are going on. Okay, here is Bruegel's Hunters in the Snow. So a picture from Northern Europe. And so this is the sorts of conditions that you do not see there at the present time, as existed during the Maunder minimum, when there was hardly any sunspot activity and lots of cosmic rays getting in, forming lots of clouds. And it's interesting, if you look at practically any painting that's taken from that, or that was done during that interval, they always tend to have this sort of a hazy, cloudy sort of look to them, which reflects the sort of enhanced clouds conditions that existed, which resulted in the overall cooler type conditions. Now, the final thing that I'll talk about right here is we looked at a little ice age record, actually from our core records up at Belize Inlet. So I'm not going to bore you. There's a way that we can look at the distribution of fossils in particular samples that live at the present time. So you go all different conditions, low oxygen, high oxygen, warm, cool, or whatever. And then we can correlate them to tell us about what the conditions are that exist at that present time. So this is a diagram which shows this. Here's the more interesting bit right here, is that we can actually then look at these different species that live around here, and you can see that in a very short freeze core that we took from Belize Inlet, that there was a radical change in this place. So there was some of these species were very abundant deeper in the core, then we changed to a totally different set. And using this thing called the transfer function, we can ascribe oxygen values and temperatures to these distribution of these fossils. And what we saw, the interesting thing is that at a point right here, and I think I'll move to another slide to show that, is that here is the transfer function. This is dated from about 1000 AD up to the present time in here. Up until about 1500 AD, oxygen levels in Belize Inlet were very low. Then almost instantly, they moved up to much, much higher levels. The same thing with temperature. Temperature was higher, then almost instantly around 1500, we moved to a lower temperature, which stayed all through the 1800s until the latter part of the 1800s, when it gradually the temperature started to drop off and oxygen started to drop off as well, which matches up beautifully with a little ice age. So I think what we're seeing here is another one of these Gleisberg cycle shifts that we're looking at. And here's just a little model to show how this happened, is that Belize Inlet, during the time when oxygen levels were low, basically, it rained a lot in this area. So enhanced rainfall, which resulted in a very thick wedge of fresh water going across that very narrow little Natwako rapids out here. Water couldn't get in from the open ocean at all. And it resulted in this water in here becoming very stagnant. Then, as we moved on later, Belize Inlet, as we moved the North Pacific High began to dominate in that area, it resulted in lower salinity water leaving, but it's a thinner wedge, and some water could actually get in, and oxygen levels start to go up again. And so it can happen very, very quickly. It doesn't take much. If you add a lot of water into this very narrow little inlet up there, it can result in a serious restriction of the amount of exchange going on and almost instantaneous development of anoxia. So this is our little ice age record that we see in this region as well, which is controlled by, again, these movements in the North Pacific High and Aleutian Low. It's not upwelling. We're looking at changes in actual rainfall at this stage. So finally then, the conclusion that we've drawn from this research carried out over several years here, that basically we see very conclusive, I'd think, evidence of natural cyclic phenomena, which we think is driven by these celestial variation, which has an impact of the solar forcing basically being modulated by cosmic ray flux, which seems to be a prime driver of not only climate in the Northeast Pacific, but also has a profound influence upon biological processes as well. And that is it.